It was by one union that we achieved our independence and liberties, and by it alone can they be maintained. James Monroe.
Oh, hi. Mr. Lahasky here, and today we're going to explore the rise of American nationalism in the early decades of the 19th century. Remember, when the United States was first established, it was conceived as a loose confederation between 13 independent states. Even as Washington, Hamilton, and Adams tried to bring the states under the fold of a growing national government in the 1790s, many Americans continued to identify first with their home state. This began to change, however, in the early 1800s. During this time, Americans across the country looked back fondly on their shared revolutionary history. They marveled at the success and stability of the democratic system they had built, and they began seeing themselves as important and increasingly powerful members of the international community. This emerging sense of national pride was further nurtured by a period of economic growth and political stability known as the Era of Good Feelings. But the road to stability was anything but easy. In 1812, the Americans found themselves in the throes of war with Great Britain for the second time. The War of 1812 and the rise of American nationalism are the subject of today's lecture. But first, let's ask a big question. Who won the War of 1812? So when it comes to the United States, it seems that war is never too far in the rearview mirror, nor too far beyond the horizon. And for as long as the United States has been a nation, its citizens have debated the merits of war. The U.S. has participated in 5 declared wars and dozens of undeclared ones. In many of these conflicts, including the Revolutionary War, the Mexican-American War, and World War II, the United States has come out an undisputed victor. In others, like Vietnam, the United States failed to achieve its objectives. Others still are harder to call. The War of 1812 falls into this category. The U.S. entered the war with a clear set of objectives, but by the war's end, none of them had been achieved. Yet, the War of 1812 ushered in a period of unbridled prosperity and growth in the United States. Was this period a product of the American war effort, or did the war simply delay the inevitable growth of the nation? Let's take a look. Our first big idea lays out the causes for the War of 1812. The War of 1812 had 3 main causes: British impressment of American sailors, British violation of neutral shipping rights, and British instigation of American Indians on the frontier. In essence, Americans sought the respect of their former mother country. You'll remember that Thomas Jefferson handed James Madison a bit of a mess in 1808. The American economy was in the throes of a deep depression brought on by the embargo of 1807. And relations with Britain were approaching their lowest point since the American Revolution. During Madison's first term, the economy did manage to recover some, thanks to the repeal of the embargo in 1809. But tensions with Britain remained high for several reasons. First, the British policy of impressment, which had begun during the Jefferson administration, continued. Desperate to staff the Royal Navy in the face of shortages and defections, the British kidnapped American sailors on the high seas and forced them to serve in Britain's fight against Napoleon. Second, the British were interfering with American merchant ships attempting to carry out business in Europe. International law held that neutral nations like the United States were entitled to free navigation of the seas and open commerce, even during times of war. But British blockades in Europe were preventing Americans from carrying out their overseas trade. Finally, tensions rose when evidence emerged that the British were instigating American Indians on the western frontier. Relations between the U.S. government and Native Americans had been shaky ever since American independence, but in the early 1800s, resistance intensified. Chief Tecumseh and Tenskwatawa, a pair of brothers from the Shawnee tribe, organized a coalition of natives known as the Pan-Indian Confederacy. The Confederacy encouraged First Nations people to resist U.S. expansion and drive whites off of their ancestral lands. In 1811, Tenskwatawa launched a premature attack while his brother was out recruiting more warriors. The Pan-Indian Confederacy was defeated soundly at the Battle of Tippecanoe River. Future President William Henry Harrison commanded U.S. troops in the victory, and he rode his Tippecanoe fame all the way to the White House in 1840. But the battle sparked controversy because in the aftermath of the fighting, Harrison's troops recovered British weapons from the battlefield. The uprising, it seemed, had been supported, if not instigated, directly by the British. So as the election of 1812 approached, Americans grew divided on the best course of action against the British. Democratic Republicans in the West and South were known as war hawks. They demanded military action against Great Britain. The Federalists in the North, however, were doves. They opposed war, mainly for economic reasons. The Northeastern economy was just beginning to recover from Jefferson's embargo, largely thanks to trade with Britain. The last thing these states wanted was to go to war with their closest trading partner. Madison of Virginia heard the calls for war from the members of his party and responded accordingly. In June of 1812, he requested a declaration of war from Congress for the three reasons we've already discussed: impressment of sailors, interference with neutral shipping rights, and instigation of Native Americans. Days later, America officially went to war with Great Britain. Now, if we read between the lines of Madison's war message, we can see that this was not a war of self-defense nor ideology. Some textbooks call the War of 1812 the Second War for Independence, but it wasn't that either. The War of 1812 was about respect. Many Americans interpreted the actions of the British as indications that the young country was not yet seen as an equal on the global stage. When they called for war in 1812, they sought to solidify America's position in the international community. Madison asked for a war that each of his predecessors had sought to avoid. The decision was validated by his re-election in 1812, but now he faced the challenge of winning a war with Great Britain for the second time in less than 40 years. The course of the war is outlined in our second big idea. The war's first 2 years witnessed few American successes, and by late 1814, both sides hobbled towards a peace treaty. From the war's outset until late in 1814, Madison's decision to go to war appeared to be a colossal mistake. American military leadership hoped to quickly invade British Canada, capture Montreal, and force the Brits to the negotiating table. But the campaign never materialized. Federalist governors in the Northeast refused to mobilize state militias for a war that they opposed. Without the support of the robust New England militias, the U.S. Army had little hope of a successful campaign. A second Canadian invasion was attempted from the West, where governors were more cooperative, but the disorganized forces there were turned away by the British at the Great Lakes. Any hope for a quick victory soon evaporated. In addition to the setbacks on the battlefield, the war devastated the U.S. economy. Recognizing their superiority on the seas, the British employed a naval blockade to crippling effect. British ships intercepted American trade vessels, confiscating property and essentially suffocating the United States of all foreign trade. To give you an idea of how effective this was, American exports in 1807 had totaled $107 billion. In 1814, that number was down to only $7 million. Paying for the war also presented a huge problem for the Americans. Despite that their party had wanted the war, Democratic Republicans in Congress refused to raise taxes to pay for it. To make matters worse, banks were unwilling to lend to the United States, as many began to doubt whether the country would survive long enough to pay back the loans. The United States was running out of money, and fast. Then, just when it seemed like things couldn't get any worse, they did. In April 1814, Napoleon was forced out of power in Europe. This was bad news for the Americans, since Britain could now focus all of its attention and resources on the war with the United States. The British planned a three-pronged invasion that they hoped would deliver a knockout blow: a ground invasion of the Northeast from Canada, a campaign along the Atlantic coast near Washington, and an assault on New Orleans from the Gulf of Mexico. The Americans, too, adopted a new strategy: try to survive. The first two talons of the British plan saw mixed success. Finally aided by Northeastern militias, the U.S. Army was able to defend against the British invasion from Canada. But the Americans suffered a blow on the Atlantic coast. In August 1814, British forces entered Washington and set fire to much of the town, including the White House, the Capitol, and a number of other government buildings, before they were finally turned away at Baltimore. This was a huge symbolic defeat for the United States. It seemed as though American democracy was burning to the ground, literally. So by late 1814, the situation was dire. But fortunately for the Americans, the British were also exhausted. Decades of war with the French had drained the crown of its own resources, so diplomats from both sides met in Ghent, Belgium, to draw up a peace treaty. By Christmas Eve, they had one. The Treaty of Ghent ended hostilities and restored relations between the two countries status quo ante bellum, or before the war. Basically, both sides agreed to pretend that the whole war never happened. So, looking back on the big question, who actually won? From a military perspective, it was probably a draw. Neither side achieved any major strategic goals on the battlefield, and casualty numbers were fairly even. From a political standpoint, it's also hard to say who the real winner was, but the treaty makes it pretty clear that it wasn't the United States. Remember, the U.S. declared war for three reasons: impressment of sailors, violation of neutral shipping rights, and instigation of Native Americans on the frontier. None of these issues were addressed or resolved by the Treaty of Ghent. The U.S. therefore achieved none of its original objectives. How then could anyone suggest that the U.S. won this war? Then again, in one area, the United States was definitely a winner: public perception. In one of the weirder storylines in American history, the U.S. managed to make it look like they won the War of 1812, despite the fact that they clearly did not. This is our third big idea. The timing of Andrew Jackson's victory in New Orleans gave the illusion of British capitulation, ushering in a wave of national pride and patriotism after the war's end. Okay, so to break this down, we need to take a close look at the chronology of the war's final weeks. The Treaty of Ghent was signed on December 24, 1814, but the agreement was made in Belgium, all the way over in Europe. In order for the American diplomats to deliver the good news to the United States, they had to put that treaty on a horse, carry it to a port, put it on a boat, sail it across the ocean, put it on another horse, and carry it to the capital. In the absence of the internet or even telegraph lines, it would take weeks before anyone in North America knew that the war was over. In the meantime, they continued to fight. Remember, the British had planned a three-pronged offensive against the United States. The first two phases had concluded by late 1814, but the British had set their sights on New Orleans. If they could capture the port city, they could shut down commerce on the Mississippi River and suffocate America's Western economy as they had done in the East. But assigned to defend New Orleans was a Tennessee general named Andrew Jackson, and defend it he did. While the Treaty of Ghent was still in transit somewhere in the Atlantic Ocean, Andrew Jackson won a decisive battle at New Orleans on January 8, 1815. The battle was the most lopsided of the entire war, with the British sustaining over 2,000 casualties compared to only 62 on the American side. News spread quickly of Jackson's victory at New Orleans, and newspapers printed that perhaps the battle represented a turning point in the American war effort. Days later, the treaty arrived in Washington. So, to the average American, it appeared as though Jackson's victory had brought on the end of the war. Across the country, Americans celebrated their victory, and of course, American politicians leaned into this misconception and claimed that America had yet again defeated the mighty British Empire. And indeed, the euphoria of the war's end brought on a wave of national pride and patriotism that pervaded American culture. Francis Scott Key's famous 1814 poem, The Defense of Fort McHenry, was set to music and became one of the most popular patriotic songs in the country. You know it today as the Star-Spangled Banner. Visual artists celebrated the United States by depicting key moments in American history. You've probably seen John Trumbull's iconic images of the signing of the Declaration of Independence and Washington's victory at Yorktown, but what you may not know is they were actually painted after the War of 1812. Americans' pride in their democratic experiment also manifested in architecture. The new Capitol building and many other government buildings were constructed in the neoclassical style, which paid homage to ancient Greece, the birthplace of democracy and the inspiration of Enlightenment thought. All of these cultural trends reflected a new sense of nationalism that owed its rise to the peculiar circumstances of the War of 1812. But nationalism after the War of 1812 wasn't limited to art and architecture. Political and economic developments of the war's aftermath also reflect that trend. Our fourth big idea explains. The decade after the War of 1812, also known as the Era of Good Feelings, was characterized by economic prosperity and political stability, each of which contributed to national unity. The general sense of nationalism that pervaded American society in the 1810s and early 1820s traces economic and political causes. Historians refer to this period as the Era of Good Feelings because, well, people felt good about being American. The economy underwent a significant expansion after the war, and national politics were far tamer than they had been in the country's early years. This sense of stability contributed to national unity in a variety of ways. Economically, the Era of Good Feelings was highlighted by the Market Revolution. The Market Revolution, sometimes referred to as the First Industrial Revolution, witnessed drastic changes in the way manufacturing and commerce were conducted, especially in the North. The Embargo Act and the British blockade during the war had served as a sort of stimulus for American manufacturing. Since Americans couldn't rely on imports during that time, they were forced to produce more themselves. Furthermore, technological advances like the steam engine and the cotton gin led to the rise of the American factory, and more Americans began to go to work for hourly wages rather than for the price of the goods they produced. This expansion of American manufacturing allowed foreign trade to flourish after the war, which created economic stability and prosperity across the country. And this stability was present in national politics as well. The partisan infighting that had characterized America's formative years seemed to fade away after the War of 1812. In fact, during the Era of Good Feelings, America featured only one viable political party, the Democratic Republicans. Democratic Republicans controlled the White House and Congress continuously from 1800 to 1824, a record that still stands to this day. Largely, the success of the Democratic Republicans during this time was a function of the demise of the Federalist Party in the early 1800s. The party dissolved for two main reasons. First, Alexander Hamilton's death in 1804 left the party without clear leadership. Second, Federalist actions during the War of 1812 soured the party in the minds of many Americans. A little explanation here is needed. Late in 1814, when the war was still going quite badly for the United States, Federalist delegates from five northeastern states met at Hartford, Connecticut. The northeastern economy had been hit especially hard by the British blockade, so the purpose of the Hartford Convention was to discuss and organize a Federalist response. Fearing that the country would not survive on its current course, some delegates proposed that the northeastern states secede from the Union and make peace with Great Britain. When news of Jackson's victory and the Treaty of Ghent broke only weeks later, the Federalists looked like traitors who had wanted to abandon the Union and make peace with the enemy. It was a public relations blow from which the party could not recover. Now, to the credit of the Democratic Republicans, the party of Jefferson adapted well to the changing political landscape. Seizing on the wave of nationalism, they adopted some of the Federalists' most popular policy positions. In 1815, for example, they increased tariffs to protect the burgeoning manufacturing industry. In 1816, they renewed the charter for the National Bank for another 20 years. And throughout the Era of Good Feelings, Democratic Republicans expanded the scope of the federal government by funding internal improvements like the National Road, subsidizing railroad construction, and establishing national universities. The party established a wide appeal that catapulted them to landslide victories in the elections of 1816 and 1820. Indeed, nationalism was the order of the day in the United States, and it even extended to the United States foreign policy as well. This is our final big idea. The nationalistic foreign policy position outlined by the Monroe Doctrine established the U.S. as an isolationist nation and validated America's place in the international community. For almost a decade after the War of 1812, foreign affairs in the United States remained fairly quiet. But in the early 1820s, President James Monroe made a bold statement that set U.S. foreign policy objectives for the next century. In the first two decades of the 19th century, democratic revolutions swept Central and South America. Slowly, Latin American countries achieved their independence from old world empires. These new republics were weak and vulnerable, as the United States had been after its own revolution. And there was some fear that Europe might attempt to recolonize these countries. The United States, ever wary about having monarchical powers close to home, stepped in. In his 1823 State of the Union speech, James Monroe issued a stern warning to Europe. He declared that any new attempts to colonize the Western Hemisphere would be seen as an act of hostility against the United States. This policy position, known as the Monroe Doctrine, reflected the nationalistic trends that characterized the era of good feelings. At the root of the policy was America's self-image as protectors of democracy, at home and abroad. Taking it from another perspective, the Monroe Doctrine also sheds light on today's big question. While the U.S. may not have won the War of 1812 in an immediate sense, the thing that Americans were seeking most when they went to war was respect. By 1823, there could be little doubt that the Americans had earned it. Not a single European power tested the Monroe Doctrine. They declined to explore colonization opportunities at the insistence of the United States. By 1823, the U.S. had arrived as a major player in the international community. So I like to think of this period of American history as America's preteen years. The United States navigated a changing landscape, all the while grappling with its own identity. The U.S. made important decisions regarding who it was, what it stood for, and what it was proud of. The era of good feelings helped to solidify that identity. But like any period of prosperity, it did not last forever. And as is true of many teenagers, there were tumultuous times on the horizon. I'll leave you today with Johnny Horton's famous 1959 chart topper, The Battle of New Orleans, which commemorates Andrew Jackson's victory at the Crescent City. Next time, we'll see the national unity of the era of good feelings dissolve into sectional differences. Differences that will send the nation down a course towards civil war. See you then.
In 1814, we took a little trip along with Colonel Jackson down the mighty Mississippi. We took a little bacon and we took a little beans, and we caught the bloody British in a town in New Orleans. We fired our guns and the British kept a-coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. We looked down a river and we see the British come, and there must have been 100 of them beating on the drum. They stepped so high and they made the bugles ring. We stood beside our cotton bales and didn't say a thing. We fired our guns and the British kept a-coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. Old Hickory said we could take them by surprise if we didn't fire our muskets till we looked them in the eye. We held our fire till we see their faces well. Then we opened up our squirrel guns and really gave them well. We fired our guns and the British kept them coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. Yeah, they ran through the briars and they ran through the brambles and they ran through the bushes where a rabbit couldn't go. They ran so fast that the hounds couldn't catch them on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. We fired our cannon till the barrel melted down, so we grabbed an alligator and we fought another round. We filled his head with cannonballs and powdered his behind, and when we touched the powder off, the gator lost his mind. We fired our guns and the British kept a-coming. There wasn't as many as there was a while ago. We fired once more and they began to run it on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico. Yeah, they ran through the briars and they ran through the brambles and they ran through the bushes where a rabbit couldn't go. They ran so fast that the hounds couldn't catch them on down the Mississippi to the Gulf of Mexico.